Hi everyone! Welcome back to integralcalc.com. Today we're going to be doing another second order differential equations problem. And in this one, they've asked us to solve this initial value problem here. They've given us a function and two initial conditions and asked us to solve the initial value problem. So we're going to need a couple of formulas first. We'll need the product rule later on. This is the second order differential equations formula that we'll need, and it's a two-part formula that also involves this p plus or minus qi. And then we'll need the quadratic formula in order to solve for our roots, which you'll see in a second. So the first thing we want to do with this problem is convert our original function here that involves the variable y to an equation that involves the variable r. So we're going to be replacing y's with r's. And I think the easiest way to do it, it's a quick little trick that I use. I count the hash marks on each y variable. So let's pull up what our equation is going to look like. So we're going to replace each of the y variables with r, but we have to decide what our exponent is going to be on our y variables down here. So I count the hash marks. So here we have y with two hash marks, which means we're going to have r squared. And you can see we replaced with r squared here. Here we have y with one hash mark, so we're going to replace that with r to the 1, or just r, and you can see we replaced that there. Here for y, we have y with 0 hash marks, so we're going to replace that with r to the 0, but r to the 0 is just 1, so we multiply 20 times 1, we just get 20, that kind of drops away. But that's how we replace y's with r's. And the reason that we're going to do that is because we're going to now use this equation to solve for r, and that'll give us the roots or solutions to our equation, and we'll be able to plug those into this formula here. So we will normally try to factor this equation. In this case, we can't easily factor it, so we're going to need to use the quadratic formula here to solve for r. And remember that with the quadratic formula, a is the coefficient on your squared term, so in our case, 1. B is the coefficient on r here, so that in our case that's 4. And C is the third term here that doesn't have the variable attached to it, so in our case that's 20. So we'll be plugging in 1 for A, 4 for B, and 20 for C into our quadratic formula here. And this is what we get, and when we simplify a couple steps, we'll end up with negative 4 plus or minus the square root of negative 64 all over 2. Now the first thing that we need to notice is that we have a negative number now inside of our square root sign, which means we're going to end up with an imaginary solution, and we represent an imaginary solution with this variable I. And remember that I is equal to the square root of negative 1 when we're talking about imaginary numbers or imaginary solutions. So we will convert this solution to the square root of 64 times the square root of negative 1. This here is the same as just the square root of negative 64. And the reason we do that is because obviously when we take the square root of 64, we'll get 8. And remember we said that the square root of negative 1 was equal to I. So this whole thing here just becomes I in our solution. If we divide through by 2, r will end up equal to negative 2 plus or minus 4i. Now notice that this solution is in the exact same form as this p plus or minus qi, which was the second part of this two-part formula here for second-order differential equations. So the information we need to pull out of this solution is p and q. So you can see that since they're in the same form, negative 2 will be equal to p up here, and 4 will be equal to q. So we will now plug in negative 2 for p right here, and 4 for q both here and here. And here's what that looks like. So now that we've solved for r and we've identified p and q and plugged those into our formula for y of x, we found our y of x equation, which is super important. So we've gotten that far. The rest of the way, we're going to be doing a couple things. First, we're going to take the derivative of y of x to get y prime of x. And once we do that, we will plug in our two initial conditions here, y of 0 equals 9. This one will be plugged into our original native y of x equation. And we'll be plugging in y prime of 0 equals 10 to y prime of x, or the derivative of this equation. So we'll match those up, and we'll get two equations back that both involve C sub 1 and C sub 2. And with those two equations, we'll use, you know, a method of substitution or simultaneous equations to solve for C sub 1 and C sub 2. And whatever we get, we'll plug back into this y of x equation here for C sub 1 and C sub 2, and whatever we get will be our final answer. So let's go ahead and start off. So I guess the way I have it here, we'll plug in the initial condition first, and then we'll take the derivative and plug in its corresponding initial condition. So in this case, we have y of x, so we're going to take this initial condition here. We'll be plugging in 0 for x, and we'll set it equal to 9. So when we plug in 0 for x and we set it equal to 9, we notice a couple things. First, this first term here simplifies to e to the 0. Anything raised to the 0 power is 1. So this first term will reduce to 1, which we've written down here. As for everything inside the parentheses, c sub 1 and c sub 2 will remain. And to evaluate cosine of 0 and sine of 0, you can just use your calculator. The technically correct way to do it would be to pull up your unit circle and look at that. Cosine at the angle where the angle is equal to 0 on the unit circle. Remember that when we're using the unit circle, we're looking at the angle 0. Cosine is going to be the x-coordinate at that location, and sine is going to be the y-coordinate at that location. So at the angle 0, cosine, the x-coordinate, is going to be equal to 1. So in place of cosine of 0, we put a 1. Sine at the angle 0 is going to be the y-coordinate at that angle. In this case, the y-coordinate is 0. So sine of 0 gets replaced with 0. And simplifying that, you can see this whole term will go away. This 1 outside is redundant. We're just left with c sub 1 times 1 equals 9, and therefore c sub 1 is equal to 9. So we've already solved for c sub 1. We need to now take the derivative of y of x to get y prime of x and use this second initial condition to solve for c sub 2. So taking the derivative, it's a little bit long. We're going to need to use the product rule, which hopefully by now you're familiar with. But we will treat e to the negative 2x as our first function, f of x, here in product rule, and everything here inside the parentheses as our second function, g of x. And when we do that, here's what we're going to get for the derivative. Remember that we'll take the derivative of f of x, so that's the derivative of e to the negative 2x, which is negative 2 e to the negative 2x, and then we leave g of x completely alone. So everything inside the parentheses, leave that untouched. Then we move on and we add f of x untouched, so e to the negative 2x stays as it is right here, and then we take the derivative of g of x, g prime of x, so we're taking the derivative of everything here inside the parentheses. So when we take the derivative of this part right here, remember that c sub 1 and c sub 2 are going to act like coefficients on these terms, so they're going to stay right where they are. They're not like variables. They're just like a coefficient in front of this cosine of 4x and sine of 4x. So we're really looking at the derivative here of cosine of 4x. And for that, we'll need to apply chain rule because we have 4x inside of the cosine. So looking at the derivative of cosine, the derivative of cosine is negative sine. So you can see we've brought this negative term out, or this negative sign out in front, and then we have sine here. So negative sine, leaving the 4x completely alone. This is chain rule, right? So we leave that 4x, but then according to chain rule, we have to multiply by the derivative of the inside part, which is 4x. The derivative of the inside 4x is 4, so we multiply by 4, and that's where we get the 4 right there. Again, we'll need to apply chain rule to the second term here, so treat sine as the outside function and 4x as the inside function. So taking the derivative of the outside sine, the derivative of sine is cosine, so you can see we have that, and we leave the 4x completely alone, because we take the derivative of the outside, leave the inside alone. But then we have to multiply by the derivative of the inside, which the inside is 4x, so the derivative is 4, so you can see we've multiplied by 4 here. And we leave c sub 1 and c sub 2 alone, as we said before. So now this is going to be a bit of simplification. What we're going to do, actually, without simplifying, we'll just go straight to plugging in our initial condition. So y prime of 0 equals 10 means that we're going to plug 0 in for x, which you can see we've done everywhere here. And we're going to set it equal to 10. So you can see we've set it equal to 10 right here. And now we're going to go ahead and simplify. Remember that anything raised to the 0 power is 1. So e to the 0 will be 1. We'll end up with negative 2 out in front. Again, for all of these sine and cosine, you'll need the unit circle to evaluate, or you can just plug it into your calculator either way. But cosine of 0 is equal to 1. Sine of 0 is equal to 0. Again, this e to the 0 is just 1, so that part drops away. It would be redundant to write the 1 in front. Sine of 0 is 0, so we plug that in, and we just are left with this negative 4c sub 1 times 0. And then cosine of 0, again, is 1, so in place of cosine of 4 times 0, we plug in 1. And now to simplify further, we will multiply this out. We'll have negative 2 times c sub 1 plus 4 times c sub 2. This term will drop away. This term will drop away here, and we'll just be left with 4 times c sub 2. We set that equal to 10. And now we will use the fact that we solved for c sub 1 earlier. We found that it was 9. We'll plug in 9 for c sub 1. And this is kind of that simultaneous equations part where we substitute in one value so that we can solve just for c sub 2. So when we multiply those together, we'll get negative 18 plus 4 c sub 2 equals 10. If we add 18 to both sides to try to get c sub 2 by itself, we'll get 4 c sub 2 equals 28. And then dividing both sides by 4 gives us c sub 2 equals 7. So now that we've solved both for c sub 1 and c sub 2, we'll plug them back into our equation that we found earlier for y of x. Remember that we had previously solved for both p and q. We said that p was equal to negative 2, which is how we got this coefficient right here, and that q was equal to 4, which is why we have 4x both inside of the cosine function and the sine function. And then for c sub 1 equals 9, c sub 1 was the coefficient here, so we plug that in. And then c sub 2 was the coefficient on the sine term, so we plug in 7 in place of c sub 2. And that's it. This is our final answer. We leave it in this form. You can multiply or distribute the e to the negative 2x if you want, but it's cleanest to leave it factored like this. So I hope that helps you guys, and I will see you in the next video.